I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
Hello and welcome to the very first episode of the Advertising Podcast. It's a podcast about how AI will aid our advertising and marketing. Advertising? Yeah, that's a word. That's a word now. That is what this podcast is all about. This is certainly no Bible, and I am certainly no AI guru. The reason I'm doing this, though, is because clearly everything I see nowadays is all AI, AIO. So we're off to old McDonald's farm to see what it's all about. In terms of full disclosure, it's pretty obvious this is unscripted. I think it would be quite nice to basically blur everything out for the very first time. I also want to keep it... dynamic's way too strong a word, but I want to do something fairly quickly because AI is moving so fast that I can say something on a Monday and then 2 weeks later it's all irrelevant because something new's just dropped. So this is my brain dump for the very first one to say this is what I currently think about AI. And I think it will be interesting to look back in 6 months' time when I'm sat on a street corner selling the big issue, thinking, yeah, you got that wrong, didn't you, boy? Or equally, it could be that in 6 months' time, I think, yeah, it's exactly like I thought it would be. So we'll just dive straight into it. So in terms of who on earth I am, so I'm a creative director. I've been a creative director for about 30 years. I've seen a lot of things come and go. And obviously AI is the latest, you know, hot topic. Obviously the very first one, I guess, was the Macintosh computer, which, again, that was going to end everybody's careers. And the second thing, obviously, that was massive was the internet. And again, that changed effectively everything, as opposed to doing bus sides and bus backs and 48 sheets. You were suddenly, you know, working on web banners and websites and stuff. But what was always a constant and what has been a constant throughout is the need for an idea, a big idea. And it doesn't matter what the where that idea is, it's always something that people want. And I think that's the part that is the kind of gold dust, and how, what tool you use to create it, whether it's, you know, a magic marker, a Mac, or Midjourney, it still needs an idea to sort of drive it all. So in terms of what I actually use at the moment, I mean, I use Midjourney, I use a little bit of ChatGPT. I'm going to hopefully fairly soon use Adobe Firefly. And the other day, obviously, a Photoshop beta dropped, and that has a lot of very interesting AI functions in it as well. So I think we're just converging at the moment, and every single thing is AI. That's why I really want to start talking about it, because it feels like we're on the sort of first step of a ladder. And at the moment, I just don't know how fast this ladder's going up. In terms of, you know, Midjourney, I started using it probably 7 months ago. And like most people, the first time I used it was like, oh my God, this is amazing. I think I typed in, again, like most people did, I think I typed in Baby Superman as my first prompt, and came back sort of really quickly with these really, really sort of cool images of Baby Superman. And I looked at that and I thought, God, how long would that take me if I had to come up with a baby Superman? That would take me ages to sort of model in a 3D program. And then I thought, actually, the thing, I guess, is that I wouldn't actually have any use for that sort of stuff. And then you got a lot of images on Instagram, and it was sort of, you know, some actor as a baby, and just sort of hundreds of pictures of sort of superheroes as babies, actors as babies. And although they're all really cool and you think, yeah, that's really, really sort of impressive stuff, you step back and you think, but if you couldn't create it quickly in AI, you just wouldn't bother, because there's almost no point. It's almost like a fun parlor trick. And it's a pleasing image, but it's not something I ever would be able to use in advertising. And so I was sort of, yeah, initially I was impressed, but then I thought, actually, let's try and use it in my work. And I quite quickly got frustrated because it didn't offer me the level of granular sort of changes that I really wanted. And I realized actually I can still use, Adobe Stock and Photoshop and Cinema 4D and come up with an image that is way closer to what I had in my mind. Because Midjourney would sort of had a look that was a little bit plasticky. It was obvious it was computer generated. It was still amazingly good, and it was great for coming up with something really quickly that looked okay. But when you wanted to push it to that extra level and art direct the shot as you normally would, it just you couldn't do it. I spent days probably messing around with it until in the end I thought, ah, this is in a year's time, this is going to be brilliant. Fast forward 1 month and Midjourney released version 5 of the program, and suddenly it went up so many levels, and it's like, whoa, this thing now is absolutely usable. And I used it for the first time on a client project probably about 3 weeks ago, and it was a bizarre thing. It was a picture of a horse jumping over something, and it was a specific angle I was after, and I couldn't find a picture on Adobe Stock or any of the stock libraries that was the right sort of angle. And after spending sort of 40 minutes scouring through the stock libraries, I suddenly thought, actually, I wonder if Midjourney will produce anything. And I typed in like the simplest prompt. I think it was equine horse jumping fence or something like that. And the very first set of four images, there was one that was pretty well perfect. I then pushed, variations, and I got one that was ideal. The only thing was it was jumping over a fence, and the back feet weren't there. But I realised I could use that image, take the front feet, Photoshop them into the back, and I suddenly had an image. And so within sort of 5 or 10 minutes, I had exactly what I wanted. This was a really good picture. It wasn't some sort of, dodgy, clearly computer generated thing. It just looked like a photo. And at that point, I thought, okay, we're now in a new level. And then a week or so later, I started using it on other projects, and I'm kind of hooked now. I used it all of last week. Every single image I came up with, I started with Midjourney. So I'm using it a lot now. And when I say I use it, I've never just taken a shot straight out of Midjourney and used it in an ad. And it's not just because I like to fettle, but they're never quite right, but they sort of they're close enough that I can, kind of go from there. So in terms of my workflow, obviously I first of all need to come up with an idea so I know what I'm searching for. I tend to use photography as my sort of primary source, and that's partly because it's the sort of most accessible in terms of like all stock libraries have lots of photographs, and then I use Photoshop to, alter things. So I might find an image as a start point in, say, Adobe Stock, and then actually, if I use that picture as well, I can cut that part out of there. And then if I put that texture on, and I sort of develop an image from all of these sort of little sources. Or I might have to use Cinema 4D and then work into it from there. And now all that's happened really is that Midjourney has sort of taken over from Adobe Stock. So in terms of a great paradigm shift, it's not a huge difference for me. It's just as opposed to using Adobe Stock for my images, I use Midjourney for my images. And it's almost like an image library that it's got a lot more images in effectively. And what's really good about Midjourney is before you sort of, I mean, quite often I'd come up with an idea and then I'd look for an image and I just couldn't find an image that was right. And so you almost cop out and you think, okay, I'll come up with another idea. Because ultimately I have budgets I have to work to, and I, more importantly, probably I have time scales to work for. And I think with social media now, those time scales are getting shorter and shorter. And so sometimes you might only have sort of a day or two to come up with, a banner that works. And so you can't spend, a week coming up with that perfect image, because A, there's the budget isn't there, and B, the more importantly, the time isn't there, because by the time you come up with an image, that particular thing they wanted to talk about has been and gone. There are definitely some clients that are just interested in getting something cheap. And in those instances, if it's like a logo, I say, look, just go to fiverr.com. You know, that they'll do you a logo for, you know, 50 quid or something, because there'll be somebody somewhere that is prepared to sort of do that. And I think what they do is they go on Adobe stock and, you know, they might, I don't know, type in logo with the letter T in it. And they get a picture of, you know, five logos that are made up of a letter T. They download that and then, you know, get a couple of fonts and type in, I don't know, Tracy's Tires as their logo. And that's their logo. And it's like, great, that's £50, please. And that's not the kind of work I'm interested in doing. It would just be pointless getting me to do it. I don't want to compete in that space. Because there's no idea there, and I don't really feel like I have any value. And so if they can do that in, you know, Midjourney, then great, or probably in, you know, Adobe Firefly instead, then that's good. And there's definitely a market for that sort of stuff, but as I say, it's not for me. And so if Midjourney can create that kind of stuff really quickly, it's like, well, that's no threat to me. I don't sort of worry about it and think, oh, that's my job gone, because it was never my sort of job anyway. I've never felt that when I put an invoice in, it's never, I don't look and think, oh, yeah, it's because I, you know, I use Photoshop really well there. It's always because I came up with an ad or I came up with an idea and it was a good idea. And it happened to, you know, I art directed it and made it look pretty, but that's kind of part and parcel of, you know, what we do on a day-to-day basis, and what tools we use to create that are neither sort of here nor there. I mean, back in the day, I used to spend hours and hours just actually physically, you know, creating a visual with headlines. I used magic markers to sort of, you know, draw up the visual, and something called a Grant projector, which you had Letraset back in the day, which was sort of stuff that you used to rub down. You used to spend ages and a lot of money to create this stuff. But I used to just have a Letraset catalogue shoved under this Grant projector, and I used to sort of hand draw these headlines. And it took ages. It took like hours to create, you know, a headline, and then you magic market up this visual and you present it to the client. And if the client said, nah, I don't like that ad, it was kind of soul destroying, because it's like, I've just spent so long, you know, creating this visual. And then obviously Max came along, and suddenly it's like, oh, this thing's, you know, this is going to change my life, because I no longer need to use a Grant projector to sort of draw up a headline. I can just type in lots of headlines. And so what happened, the ideas didn't get any better, but what it meant was I could produce ideas a lot quicker, or I could produce more ideas because I had more time to sort of develop them. And I wasn't spending all of that sort of back end time to develop a visual. So if we had like 5 days to create a campaign, back in the old days, we used to think after sort of 3.5-4 days, right, we got to stop now. We got to see what ideas we do, because I need a day and a bit to start drawing this stuff up. Whereas, you know, when a Mac came along, we could just sort of develop the ads as we went. So everything was, you know, the more time you had, the more ideas you could come up with. And not always, but it's sort of almost like the more time you have, the better the idea. It's a little bit of a peculiar thing with that, because wrapped up in time is also deadlines. And I just, as a human being now, I work to a deadline. If I've got 5 days to do something, I will probably, you know, come up with loads of ideas and spin my wheels a little bit until it's like, okay, this has to now, I've got a deadline. And then you make those decisions to create a finished ad. And actually that's sort of not just in advertising, that's just life in general, the way I work now, which is not the greatest thing, because you sort of build in a little bit of pressure into your life that you really don't need, but it's there anyway. And so of course Midjourney comes along, and I look at it and I think, ah, this is now really interesting, because I can create these ideas I have in my head. I can go into Midjourney and create this stuff a lot quicker. But I don't then sort of think, ah, great, I can come up with one ad and then just take it easy and charge a client a fortune. I can come up with more ideas, and as opposed to having, kind of five ideas, it's like, hey, you can have 10, because the time I used to spend, again, having to sort of scour those stock libraries and tweak it, I'm not spending quite so long because of Midjourney. But again, the ideas are no better. It's not like I suddenly got some great ideas because I have Midjourney. It's just that donkey work, that grunt work is taken away from me. And that's the part of it I never particularly enjoyed. I mean, yeah, I could do it, but it's not in the same way that I, if I'm decorating my house, once I've got the main colour and I know what it's going to look like, it's tedious cutting around the edges and doing those little detail bits, because it's like, okay, that's the idea, and then, you're kind of on to the next thing. So in terms of my workflow, I will charge the client for an ad, and if I obviously then give them lots of options for that one ad, and sometimes I'm kind of up on the deal because I might come up with, a few ads, and they see one and it's great straight away and it just gets approved. And so in that instance, yeah, I'm up on the deal. But equally, there are times that I will come up with a raft of ideas and they don't like any of them. And so I have to sort of come up with another round of ideas. And again, I don't charge for, redoing ads, because it's kind of not really their fault. I feel like they've asked me for an ad. I need to deliver an ad, and they shouldn't have to pay because I can't come up with an idea. Having said that, if it's a new client and you just keep on presenting stuff and you think this is a really good ad, you haven't chosen it, there is a point where you think, okay, we're not on the same wavelength. So, eventually you get an ad, you lick your wounds, and then you never come back. But the clients I work for, they kind of like my work and I love their products. So that's sort of how I do an advertising campaign. But obviously, if it's just a web banner or a LinkedIn post, they're not going to get 10 ideas. They'll probably get one. If they're lucky, they'll get two. But so last week I used Midjourney for the first time all week, and the images that were coming out were really good. I was really impressed with them. They looked sort of how I wanted them to look, and so I did actually, because I could do things a lot quicker, then the client got two ideas for each of the sort of things I had to work on. And obviously they went for one and rejected the other, which was fine. But it was really interesting to have spent all week on Midjourney, and it wasn't because I was, wanted to do anything quickly. It's like this was a really good way of creating content, and it was very, very close to what I wanted. Whereas stock libraries, by their nature, sometimes they're pretty good, but it's not quite what you had in mind, but it's okay. Because the thing that's really good with Midjourney is you can get sort of an image you want, and then you can click on the variations, and it keeps giving you slightly different variations of a certain image. You can then even say, I want that in. I mean, what I did last week is I wanted a sort of a look that was basically of golden hour lighting, and so I typed that as one of my prompts. And each image that came up, A, it was kind of what I wanted, but also it was lit in a golden hour lighting way, and that's not something I've been able to, easily do, because, I'd go to a stock library and I might find that an image that is the right kind of content, but the lighting isn't sort of particularly good, or it doesn't look how I wanted there. Then you end up going into Photoshop and you artificially have to create the look you want, which is possible to a certain extent. But say with Midjourney last week, I was really, niching down on the image I wanted, and it was very impressive. And you looked at it, and it's like that didn't actually take me, forever to do. But I go back to the thing that I've said all along, is that I needed to have the idea I wanted in order to tell Midjourney, what I wanted it to come up with. Exactly in the same way that with a stock library, I need to have an idea in order to put something into the search engine to look for. So it's not really changed too much in that regard. It really is just a different version of a stock library from my point of view. But I see people that say, this is going to end my job. And then you look at what they're doing, it's like, okay, so your job was just a photo retoucher then. Because Photoshop, the beta can, using AI, can fill in the blanks of an image if you want to extend it. And while that's brilliant, it's really handy, and I use that kind of technology. It's not changed my life. All it's done is, I say, I keep going back to it, it's taken that grunt work out of the things. Like, I could do it, but it took me, an annoying amount of time. Whereas now I can just sort of quickly do that in a few seconds. But that isn't really, what our jobs should be. It's not, I mean, yeah, we can drive Photoshop, but everybody can drive Photoshop within reason. And it's like, is that really your differentiator, that you're slightly better or you're quicker at Photoshop than somebody else? My little maxim in life has always been, if you can learn this skill by watching a YouTube video, then you are going to be in trouble, because it means everybody can learn it. Whereas coming up with a good idea for an ad, you can't learn on a YouTube video. It's just something you have to learn over time, and it takes years to sort of, gain that sort of experience. And some people just, can never do it. No matter how many hours they spend, they'll never come up with a good idea. And so I think, until that moment that, and I pretty sure it'll come at some point, until that moment that you can type into some kind of AI bot, come up with a cool ad for, I don't know, Pepsi Cola, and it spits something back that you look at and you think, okay, that is a good ad, I would be pleased with that ad. Until that moment comes along, I don't think we really should be concerned about it. We should use this AI as a brilliant tool that allows, it sort of opens up your mind to the possibilities of, giving clients, more choice, more ads, and also kind of almost grander ideas, because I no longer have to have that thing where I look at it and think, ah, that would be a nice idea, but how on earth am I going to create that image given the time scale and the budget? That's going to take me ages to do. And that kind of goes back to the sort of baby Superman things. It's like, yeah, that's a good idea, but if I have to do that, it's like, what, I'm going to create a 3D model of a baby Superman, and I'm going to have to light it, I'm going to have to texture it, or you could organize a photo shoot, and then in the end you just think, ah, look, I won't present that idea, I'll go for something that is more manageable. But it's nice if you want to create a baby Superman campaign, that you can actually, come up with that image by using Midjourney, and away you go. But having said that, I just bang stuff into Midjourney and away I go. There wasn't one image I had that was just straight out of Midjourney. I mean, each one I had a brilliant starting point, and then I sort of went from there. And it's not just because I can't stop meddling, it's just that the images weren't quite right, but they were, say, a really good start point. And then you can sort of, Photoshop away, and you can tweak it, and you can, even if it's just adjusting colours and stuff, to get, a family of images that sit really nicely together. And so I think people that are concerned that, some little oik's going to come along who has no experience at all and just, sit down and suddenly be, creating ads. I mean, yeah, they might be able to, but I think certainly the clients I have, they always, want to make some little tweaks here and there. And so you need that sort of basic skill set. It's like, yeah, I can use Photoshop, I can use this. And so whenever I look at an image, I'm comfortable that I can change it to fit what the client wants. And I think if you don't have all of that knowledge that we've gained after all those years, then you can't just sit and say to a client, look, no, sorry, I can't do that, because Midjourney wouldn't let me, because that'll get old very quickly. Having said that, it's not going to be too long, I'm sure. And certainly, I think from what I've looked at Adobe Firefly, it does have that granular ability to sit and, highlight one little area and say, have a look at that again and do better. So referring back to my original sort of horses with no back feet, I could very soon, on in Firefly, I'm going to be able to take an image and say, yeah, that's good, and then highlight the two things and just type in and say add back feet, and then they will come up with that. And so again, I go back to, it's like the idea was exactly the same from the beginning. It's a tool that's allowed me to, create the image I want. But you need to, you've got to be able to art direct the thing all the way down the line. And all it means, as opposed to me having to sit and, use a lasso tool to start, creating these back hooves, I can just say to the AI, look, do this bit for me. And it's just all the grunt work. It's the stuff that nobody really wants to do. I mean, a good example of how it sort of helped was the other day I came up with an idea. Actually, it was for this for the podcast, the little image of the microphone, and I kind of knew what I wanted. I definitely couldn't find what I wanted in Adobe stock, so I went into Mid Journey and I again typed in some pretty basic prompts. I think it was like microphone, brain, thinking, and a few lot of things, and then eventually an image that was pretty similar to the one that I've created came up. But I looked at the timestamps and I typed in like 60 different prompts because it wasn't quite what I wanted. It was getting there, but it just wasn't it yeah, for various reasons it wasn't what I wanted. And actually in the end I didn't ever get what I wanted, but that top part of the brain that looked a bit like a microphone, I had that. But then the bottom part, I went into Adobe stock and found, the sort of classic microphone image that I wanted, because I wanted it to be kind of a retro mic, and I photoshopped the two together. But it was to actually create that top section, if I'd have had to do it traditionally, it's like, okay, I've now got to create a 3D model of that, or sort of hand do it in Photoshop. And although I would have done it, the fact that I could, although I sat and said, oh, there were 60 different variations, you looked at the timestamps and each one was like a minute and a half. So within, an hour and a half, I had an image that was really, really kind of bespoke to what I wanted. And if I'd have had to do that without Mid Journey, that would have been, a long time. So it helped. But again, the idea was no better. It's not like it was a sensational idea because I had Mid Journey and an okay idea. If I'd used stock libraries, it was just an okay idea all round. So as I say, at the end of that, I have a finished image, and if it was for a client, I would sit and present it, and if they approved it, I would, when I put the invoice in, it would be for the idea. It wouldn't be because I could work Photoshop and come up with a, an image of a, whatever. I think that's just, part of what we have to do as a job. So that's my sort of overall, first brain dump of, AI as a thing. I think it's really empowering. I'm really excited for it. I'm not scared about it. However, what I'd love to have happen is somebody to sit and say, look, I don't agree with anything you've said, and this is why. And it'll hopefully open my eyes as to sort of what the concerns are, because I don't see any. I just see, exciting times ahead. Having said that, of course, we've all watched enough dystopian movies where AI takes over the world and we all sit and, exploded in a nuclear thing. And of course, if AI becomes totally out of control, then, the last thing I'm going to be worried about is whether I can invoice something for an ad that I did the day before the Earth blew up. So this is the first podcast. Thank you for listening if you've made it this far. So sorry if it's overrun way more than I thought, but I guess it's quite apt that I started the podcast with the word sorry, Dave, and now here's Dave saying sorry. So a nice little bookend in that regard. So remember to like and subscribe, and I look forward to chatting with you on next week's advertising podcast.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.